Bam, Mr. True. In this video, we're going to be talking about properties of definite integrals. And starting off, we're going to look at the definition of two special definite integrals. That is, if function f is defined at a value of a, x equals a, then we define the definite integral of f of x dx from a to a is equal to zero. Now, you can use definite integrals for other things, but if you're doing it for area and you think of my lower and my upper bound are being pushed together and being the same number, what's left in between? Nothing. So it's zero. If function f is integrable on the closed interval of ab, then we define the definite integral of f of x dx from b to a is going to be equal to same function f of x dx. Still doing a definite integral, but see our lower and upper bounds have been swapped. We have b, a, and then now we have a, b. So those variables or those values have switched places. So we're sort of like, you know, maybe instead of reading the axis left to right, we're reading it from right to left. Well, when you do that, when you take those lower and upper bounds and you swap places, you're going to get the opposite answer. So here's an answer I have from a previous video I did. The definite integral of negative x squared plus 6 dx from the closed interval of 0 to 2 gave us a value of 28 over 3. We were finding area at the time, so the area was 28 over 3 square units. Well, if I swap those values and make my lower bound instead of 0, make it 2, which doesn't seem right because it's actually 2 is greater than 0, but if we swap those variables of a and b, then we're going to get what kind of answer? Well, this says if we swap a and b, we're going to get opposite answers. So instead of positive 28 over 3, we're going to get negative 28 over 3. The additive integral property. If f is integrable on the three closed intervals determined by a, b, and then this extra value of c that we're bringing into the problem, and here's the picture of what we're talking about here. I've just drawn a function. I have our values of a and b marked off on, in this case, the x-axis, and I'm breaking in a third variable. It's kind of like if you have a, you know, an 8-foot board and you cut it into a 2-foot and 6-foot section. 2 and 6 still make 8 total feet, and that's kind of what we're talking about here. If I take this area of a, b, and I bring down another variable of c, which now has three intervals. Now, where are the three closed intervals? Well, there's one from a to c, there's one from c to b, and then it has to be closed from A to B. That's where the three closed intervals are coming from, even though you might glance at this initially and think there's only two. So it says that the closed, the definite integral of f of x dx from A to B is equal to the definite integral f of x dx from A to C, and then plus the definite integral of C to B of f of x dx. So, you know, do these two parts, in this case, since we're looking at, I've given us a diagram to look at in terms of area, you know, does this area plus this area equal the entire area? Well, it seems to make sense. And we have, for this diagram here, we'd have the, well, actually I don't need to write it, it's right here. This situation exactly fits what we see here in our property. But it's not absolutely necessary for C to lie in between the values of A and B. Now let me kind of explain what I mean by that. I've marked off this value of C here, and it still would be true that, let's see here, I'm going to write this down again, the interval, the definite integrals, definite integral, excuse me, of A to B of F of X dx. So this area from here, from A to B, is equal to the definite integral of A to C of f of x dx. Okay, so that means I'm finding in this case, because again, I'm talking about area, I've drawn this nice and so it have a positive area. From A to C, we want to find the definite integral from A to C. Well, A to C is way, way out here. So then you go, okay, well, that this property says that that should be, you know, that this whole definite integral should be equal to the integral here plus the definite integral from C to B of f of x dx. So it seems like I'm already finding a definite integral that's bigger than the green shaded area, and then you want to add even more to it? Well, if I take these values of B and C, and like if you were to read this left to right, you would go A, B, and then you get to C if you were going to read those three variables from left to right. So I'm going from A to C, and I'm going back to B. Now, let me use this property here to rewrite this second term. Definite integral A to C, f of x dx. If I swap places B and C, bring the B down here, then by swapping those two variables, what am I going to get? The answer from this and the answer from this definite integral, these are going to be opposite. So when I take the C and B and I switch places, it actually is going to come up to be subtraction. Now that should make sense, right? If I just want the area of this green shaded region and I find the definite integral from A to C, aren't I going to have to then subtract out this area here because I've gone too far? Well, that's indeed what we actually are going to need to do. So as you look at the additive interval property, it is not necessary for C to be in that closed interval of A and B. So let's get to that next screen. If f and g, functions f and g, are integrable on the closed interval of a, b, and k is a constant, then the functions k times f and f plus or minus g are also integrable on that same closed interval of a, b. That math notation is the definite integral of k f of x dx from a to b is equal to k times the definite integral of f of x dx from A to B. We can just take that constant that's in front of the function and move it out in front of the definite integral notation. If we have the definite integral of two functions being added or subtracted, again with the dx, closed interval AB, then we can take the definite integral of f, the definite integral of g, and then after that integration process, either add or subtract our answers. So what does that mean really? Why do we care about this? Because here we have the definite integral of negative x squared plus 6x plus 8 dx on the closed interval of 1 to 4. Well, this is a pretty complicated question, certainly a lot more complicated than the ones I just did in the previous video, finding areas of common geometric regions. However, this property here can allow us to take this quadratic, basically it's a parabola opening down, and split it up into small manageable parts instead of going through the Riemann sum process, or the definition of area, or the limit of sums process, whatever your book is calling it. So what we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this, given each term its own definite integral. That means we're going to have the definite integral of 1 to 4 of negative x squared plus the definite integral of 1 to 4 of 6x plus the definite integral of 1 to 4 of, oops, I forgot all the dx's. Getting all excited. Dx plus the definite integral of from 1 to 4 of 6x dx plus definite integral of 1 to 4 of 8 dx. Now, do you see what I just did there? I just came up with one long problem and made up three little small integrals. Now, this is the definite integral of a constant, so if we were to sketch this, we would see we're just going to find the area of a rectangle. This is also has a degree of 1, so this is just going to be a straight line with a slope of 6, and my guess is, well, this is either going to be in the form of, when we sketch it, we're either going to get a triangle or a trapezoid. I think it's going to be a trapezoid. And then here we have the definite integral of negative x squared dx, which we can also, it's a little bit easier to deal with these definite integrals when we have, when we're working with positive values. So I'm going to take this negative and move it out front, which is what the first property is saying that I can do. Actually, as far as that's concerned, I can take this 6 out as well, but this is pretty easily drawn, so I'm going to leave that in there. I'm going to take this negative 1, this constant of negative 1, and pull it out front, have negative, the negative or the opposite of definite integral of 1 to 4 of of x squared dx plus the definite integral of 1 to 4 of 6x dx. And the same with the 8 dx. Now, This definite integral we can answer very quickly with a sketch. This definite integral we can also answer with a sketch. The first one here, the x squared, if I don't give you the answer to this particular definite integral, then you're going to have to go through the limit process or the Riemann sums process. So I'm going to go ahead and give you the answer to this term just to save some time, because actually in my textbook where they're having you practice these problems involving the property of definite integrals, they actually give you pretty much all of these answers, and you just have to be able to break apart the question into the separate, into the small individual terms, and then use the information given. But I want to review finding the area of these common geometric regions with you, since I've only done one video on that so far. And I will give you the answer to this first one here when we come back. I'm going to step out, draw these diagrams that we need to answer the second and third terms, and also give you the answer to this first one. We'll finish with our answer, finish with our total answer, and be done with this video. Okay, so my second term was, you know, the definite integral of 6x dx. So we're looking at the function f of x is equal to 6x. I've drawn that line. It has a slope of 6 and a y-intercept of 0, and I've marked off the shaded area, which we're concerned with. And as you can see, it is the shape of a trapezoid. The area of a trapezoid is 1 half the height times b sub 1 plus b sub 2. So we have 1 half our height of, now remember the bases are the parallel sides, so our height is going from 1 to 4, or 4 minus 1 is equal to 3. My first base here, let's just mark that off as 6 units long. Our second base, which 4 times 6 is 24. You understand I'm doing the 4 because that's the upper limit of my definite integral. So 4 times 6 is 24. So we have 1 half of 3 times 6 times 24 is 30. 1 half of 30 is 15, and 15 times 3, well, 15 times 3, 10 times 3 is 30. 5 times 3 is 15, so that comes out to be 45 square units, since we're finding area. So that means that the definite integral of 6x dx is equal to 45. Off to the side here, I've said the definite integral of x squared dx from that closed interval of 1 to 4 is equal to 21. But we have the negative out here that we pulled out of the definite integral. So actually, while this is equal to 21, we have that negative out front. So let's not forget that. And then finally, of course, our constant f of x is, forgot to write that down, f of x is equal to 8. Y equals 8 is a horizontal line. Definite integral between 1 and 4. So we're just finding the area of that rectangle, which is length times width. So the area is 3 times 8, which is 24 square units, since we're finding area. And what do we have? Well, 24 minus 21 is 3, and 3 plus 45 is 48 square units. That is the end of my discussion about properties of definite integrals. And that means it's time for me to get out of here. I'm Mr. True. Go do your homework.